some animals live amongst us very, very successfully. Things like seagulls and the foxes, of course, and pigeons. But others need very specialist habitats. And just this weekend, Michaela went off with Yolo Williams to Borth Bog. Now, that is a specialist habitat, to explore and find out what they could see.
This is Borth Bog, it's sphagnum bog, and it's a very rare and special habitat. It's full of life, insects, birds, mammals, particularly plants. Some of them you'll find nowhere else. Yolo, you know this bog well, don't you?
I do, yeah. I've been coming here since I was about 5 years old.
So you'll be able to tell me a little bit more about this plant, because I find this fascinating. It's sundew, and it's a carnivorous plant.
What it has these specialised leaves, and on the end of these red stalks, you can see like dew. Well, that's like a glue. And small insects, midges and ants, get stuck in there. Then it has these specialised cells in that leaf as well that squirt out enzymes, and that breaks down the insect. It sucks out those nutrients, and all you've got left then is a dry husk.
What are we looking for? Mainly insects, I guess.
It's got to be mainly insects on a day like this, but look, if you stop here, see this? There's a track, like a path, going all the way through there, through the really boggy sphagnum bit and out over there. This'll be otter. There's really good population of otters here. Lovely, lovely animals, but that's a typical otter path there.
Unlikely to see those today.
Very unlikely, I would say, Michaela.
Oh, look, there we go.
Ah, well done, well spotted. Yeah, yeah, that is a blue damselfly. Isn't it lovely? That's a real bright azure blue colour.
Stunning. Some birds you really have to stop and listen out for, but not that one. Skylark.
Skylark, yeah. Lovely bird, isn't it?
Very loud and very noisy.
And just sings and sings and sings and sings and sings as it goes. As a kid, I remember it being fairly common farmland bird. Now in Wales, it's a heathland bird or an upland bird.
This habitat is just rich in grasses and different mosses, isn't it?
It is, a whole host of plants. All of them adapted so well to life on a wet, wet bog. Take this. Lovely name, cotton grass, for very obvious reasons. You see the white heads, these are the seed heads now bobbing in the wind up and down. And then the mosses that you see all around us. If you take up a chunk...
It's a great right, colour, look at that.
And if you squeeze that, Michaela...
Whoa!
See, it retains so much water, and that is the single most important component of this whole bog, because this will die and it forms peat. If we were to dig down here, you know, the peat can be 2 metres deep. And an interesting fact about this is that in World War I, bandages were hard to come by. So what they did, they wrapped wounds in this. So it was really, really,
really
useful. Yeah, really useful. This plant we're starting to see here now, Michaela, this is bog myrtle, typical bog plant. And if you break a piece off and smell it...
Sort of smells citronella-y. Mm.
If you rub that then on your arms and on your face, they say that it keeps midges away.
Oh, well, I need plenty of that for the live shows then, because we are plagued with midges.
So it works.
Try that.
All the plants, the insects, the birds here, they're all, every single one of them is just so special. And I just love coming here. I just think it's a fantastic place.
A walk in the bog with Yolo. What more could a girl ask for?
I did it the weekend. I went to the bog. But actually, it's very close to you. It's not very far at all. But what's amazing is you have to really get down to see the wildlife.
It's famous for having adders. Did you see any skins, anything like that?
Martin, we didn't, but probably because it wasn't warm enough.
Right, yeah.
And it's not warm enough right now to see our snakes on the snake cam. These are obviously grass snakes that we have here. And this is a pile of old grass cuttings. But in there, we know that we've got lots of snakes. And earlier on today, we found a new way of looking at them in a totally different light.
Right, here we go. Royston, may I have the camera? Oops, Now, last week, we were looking at the macro world, the tiny things that live here at Innishere. But now we're going to try something completely different. This is an infrared or thermal camera. This will pick up heat differences, and we've pointed it at the compost heap.
We set this up earlier on when there was a snake. There's a snake on top of the grass heap. That's a grass snake. Very individual, got a bit of a funny mark on its mouth there.
Going in now.
Yeah, it's going into the grass heap. We got
Richard Taylor-Jones, the cameraman. Now, this is fascinating. The hottest bits are the yellowest bits.
We should say that's inside, isn't it?
That's inside. So this camera is actually looking into the hottest bit. You can see the entrance holes there as well, looking like little tubes. And here is a grass snake. And what's absolutely fascinating is instead of basking in the sun, they are using the heat that's being generated by decomposition inside the compost heap to warm their bodies up.
The blue bits, just to really make sure everyone understands, are the cold bits, and the yellow bits are the really hot bits.
And that red thing coming out, like a bit of moving spaghetti, is the grass snake. That's absolutely fascinating.
It's incredible to see that.
So they're staying inside that very heat to warm themselves up enough so that once they're hot enough, they can go out and hunt.
But it looks, I mean, on that camera, it looks like a volcano with lots of lava.
It does.
Spinning all over.
Bursting out through the holes, yeah. Absolutely brilliant.
I'm going to ask for a spade. Can I have a spade? Thank you very much, Royston. I'm going to need this. Well, in fact, I'm not. But you and Chris are. I'll tell you more about that in just a second. First of all, Chris.
If you were watching last Thursday, you know we were very pleased to launch our survey called The Big Garden Weigh-In with the British Trust for Ornithology. And what we wanted to know was the biomass, the living weight of birds in your garden. Don't worry, we weren't asking people to rush out with scales and start weighing all of their blue tits and blackbirds. We wanted you to count them over the course of an hour. I'm very pleased to say we've had 1,677 replies to our survey so far, from as far north as the Outer Hebrides and as far south as the Channel Islands. As usual, we're not happy. We want more. And you've still got 24 hours to go, so please help us work this out. It's a measure of the productivity, the health of your garden. That's what we want to know. Details, of course, are available on our website. That's at bbc.co.uk/springwatch. Results will be published on Thursday, initial results. Now, what about the quiz? We showed you this image earlier. We asked you to identify the three animals that were there, tangled up in this iconic flag. We also wanted to know not only the names of those species, but what linked them in a jubilee theme. If you think you know the answer, go back to that website. I've just given you the details and let us know.
Right, Chris, you are going to need this. Martin's already got his.
I thought.
Because I'm going to get you to dig.
What on earth is this?
You're going to dig this little patch here, which is 20 by 20 centimetres. I must say thank you very much to Dick Squires. This is his garden. He's one of the RSPB area managers here. But the reason I'm going to get you to do this is a little challenge. I want you to see how many worms you can find in that bit of vegetable patch, and I'll tell you why in a minute. Do you accept the challenge, both of you?
I accept the challenge, Michaela.
I have to find more worms than Martin.
There will be a winner and there will be a loser. So you've got to see how many worms you can find. So if you want to start
to dig,
you can dig now. You've got about 4.5 minutes.